The safety is off. There's a round in the chamber. This is Armed Alabama, sponsored by McCoy Outdoor Company, Mobile's hometown full-line outdoor sporting products and gear store, an interactive talk show discussing self-defense, product reviews, shooting tips, safety, and more. Your calls, comments, and texts welcome at 343-0106. Now, here are your hosts, retired judge and certified NRA instructor, Rusty Johnston, and certified NRA law enforcement instructor, Adam Strange.
They're going to pry these guns right out of my hands when they come to take them away. I believe in the rights that my fathers gave me when he signed the Constitution that day. No misguided president or crooked politician with a greasy pocket be spared. When the hard-working man gets tired of your cry, it's gonna rain wrath, beware. Don't tread on me, I'm American free. You're not gonna take it away. I'll stand up and fight for my freedoms and rights. That's a price you'll have to pay. Don't tread on me, I'm American free. Red-blooded to the core. You ain't ever had a fight in your life like a fight that you're champ for.
Okay, welcome to Armed Alabama, two-hour show on self-defense, firearm ammo selection, home protection, concealed carry, range training, range etiquette, and Alabama law, Mississippi law, and the Florida law, and of course the Constitution. Glad you can join us tonight. We got a full show as usual, and we're looking forward to being here for 2 hours. Our show is from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., so be sure and hang with us for the show. We'll have a lot of information we're going to bring to you, a lot of tips and pointers. Also, we've got some information that the judge is going to bring to you. Of course, if you're following the news, you've heard about the Bonnie and Clyde wannabes on the radio or on the TV or internet. We got some more information regarding those, some breaking news. Maybe you already heard it. But just hang with us. If you would like to call into the studio, you can call at 251-343-0106. And you can text to that same number, 251-343-0106. Be sure and check us out on Armed Alabama Radio, FM Talk 106.5. That's our Facebook page. You go to Facebook and search Armed Alabama Radio, FM Talk 106.5, and you can go to our Facebook page and you can watch us live. We're broadcasting on Facebook Live. And you can also check us out on Twitter, Armed Alabama 106.5, and of course we have a website, armedalabama.com. You can go to our website at any time and you can watch all of our previous shows or listen to our previous shows, and you can go to YouTube and you can watch all of our previous live broadcasts. We have those recorded and they are uploaded to YouTube. So feel free to check it out anytime.
Plus, we have on YouTube, we have other clips of interest. We have techniques on there. We have how to avoid criminal activity. We have examples of criminal activity. We've had, Adam, one clip on there, 2 or 3 minute video. We've had almost 10,000 hits on that, which is just phenomenal. And another wow. one that actually I put together about how dangerous Walmarts are has had almost 5,000 views. So that's pretty significant. So, you know, you never know which show or which video is going to get a lot of hits, but just easiest thing is just go to YouTube and just enter the search Armed Alabama, and you'll see our symbol there, and then that's the station. And if you subscribe to it, then you'll get notification when there's a new video up.
And absolutely, that's the key thing is subscribe. And we don't really push that enough, but there's a lot of great content we have on our YouTube page, Armed Alabama. Don't just like it, but subscribe to it. And that right. way you'll be notified of all of new videos being uploaded. And that video, talking about of Walmart, and the name of that video is high crime, low prices all the time.
Yeah, right. That's right. That's exactly right. I thought that was kind of clever.
And you know, Judge, you and I have discussed.
I could do a two-hour one. I tried to keep it about 30 minutes or less. Maybe it's 20 because it's about kidnappings. It's about older ladies putting their groceries, being assaulted.
It's crazy what goes on at Walmart.
Right.
And the thing about that is you know, there's been several articles written about it. You've done a lot of research on it
since before that.
Yeah, and I think some of that is some of the articles had mentioned the contributing factors maybe to the higher rate of crime is the number of people that Walmart has per square foot of store space. They have actually dropped that number since 2006 in an effort to save money.
Yeah, they're saving money.
Right.
But, of course,
it
puts you, as
the shopper, at risk. Yeah.
And then another thing is there's a little-known policy that you can camp out at Walmart. And it started off they wanted middle-class people with their campers there at Walmart.
Or retirees what have
to
you.
To guard their store, which is kind of unbelievable. But then they also have basically homeless people in old cars that won't run that are living there. So, you know, that's kind of debatable.
I guess they didn't get that $20 to get back to Mississippi.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So it attracts a lot of police in smaller towns have complained that it is taking up more than half of their police time just to handle the problems at Walmart.
Yeah, and there was several police chiefs that stated that what they do is they just station their manpower at Walmart because something's going to happen.
That's incredible. So, you know, that's called cost shifting. They have shifted their costs to the taxpayers. And because there's a certain cost to doing everything. One thing we do want to talk about tonight, we'll take calls on any subject, but women and self-defense. We want to give you some practical tips because women are targets, like it or not. You know, men by nature tend to be predators. They commit most of the crimes. And we want to give women some tips on avoiding criminal activity. We've heard a lot from our classes, but I've seen more than I wanted to see when I was sitting on the bench, and we'll pass along some of those to you. But we got time to take him. Let's go ahead and take Mike from Saraland. Mike?
Yeah, how are you guys?
Fine. How about you, Mike?
Oh, pretty good, considering the weather, and finally my wife can relax that they got that crazy.
Oh, yeah. Mine was freaking out, and I told her, I hadn't heard about it, and I said, If the people that he kidnapped are related to him or are acquaintances of his, somehow connected to him, then you're not in danger because most people like that tend to commit crimes against people they're connected to. It's rare to have a total stranger, you know, abducted like that.
And I also want to say, Judge, I was fortunate one time to unfortunate to be a foreman on one of your trials.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Was it criminal or civil?
Yeah, it was criminal.
What kind of case was it?
It was a gentleman that he went to Mobile University of Mobile, and
I know him.
Killed a young lady,
I know him. Packer.
He reached us at the end of it, and he was up on a rape charge.
That was real upsetting.
You know which one I'm talking about.
Yeah, Daryl Packer.
Yeah, whatever happened to him.
You know, I probably can't remember 10 defendants' names, but he's pretty high on the list. Wow.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
thank you for being on that jury.
I've always wanted to tell you that I respected your court, and I believe it was one of Beth Rich's first trials. As a prosecutor,
it may have been, and I tell you, that was a real tough case trying it because
I know I was choked up when I had to read the verdict.
Oh,
and I wanted to read it.
But I don't know if we told you
people don't really realize what's in store for them when they.
I know.
I was honored and privileged to serve my time on the in the jury. But
you know, the poor girl who was the victim was dead. You know, we didn't explain that deliberately. She was murdered probably by him, but we couldn't bring that out in court.
Right, exactly.
And listen, it choked me up too. Remember the boyfriend, the fiance, his testimony? That was a tearjerker.
Well, when I had to read the verdict, I had to look at the parents.
Right.
When I was reading it, and that's what really choked me up.
Oh boy, those things.
It'd have been easier if I could have just stared him in the eyes.
Right.
Holding, but with them, her mother and dad and family sitting there, because there was some Georgia, I believe, they didn't even live here.
They were like from Atmore, I think. Good people. Good people.
But my question, I got two questions for you.
Why don't you do this?
Do
this for me. We're near break. Hold on through the break if you don't mind, and then we'll get to your question. All right?
Sure.
Okay, hold on. We'll be right back with more of Armed Alabama. All right, we are back. This is Judge Rusty Johnston on Armed Alabama, and on the phone we have Mike, who is a caller who was on a jury of mine years ago, one of the worst cases I tried, a man named Daryl Packer, who was convicted of a terrible rape, and he explained that a little earlier, and it upset both of us, I'll tell you. And now he has a question. Go ahead, Mike.
Yes. Smith & Wesson 38 revolver hammers. Have y'all done any research on that weapon?
Yeah, and I'm going to let you talk to Adam. He's more of a revolver person. I will take – well, go ahead, and you may want to explain about hammerless, not snagging at
all. Yeah, absolutely. I like it. I like it, Mike. Of course, I like revolvers. It's a really good small concealed carry pistol, you know, snub nose. I'm speaking of a small compact snub nose.
It's more or less designed for women.
And speaking of women, you know, that's tonight's ladies' nights on the show. So we're talking about self defense for women, and those were one of the things I recommend. I recommend a stainless steel or just a regular blued steel. And not ultra lightweight, featherweight, or whatever. Because
polymer, a lot of them.
Yeah, or polymer, you know, because less mass equals more recoil. And
right.
So a lump, women don't like recoil, you know. It hurts sometimes.
Well,
I don't either,
it's shocking.
Of accuracy,
so,
with a
hammerless, you know, there's nothing to be able to snag the hammer on. It won't snag on your clothing or what have you if you're drawing the pistol from your holster, which should be on your persons and not in your purse. That's
right.
One thing we don't recommend for women. Do not carry the pistol in your purse. Carry it on your persons in a good holster.
And, Mike, one thing you can do also is buy aftermarket nice grips.
Yep.
Because, you know, they kind of come with the – it's always hurt me. You buy a fairly expensive gun, and they come with a cheap grip.
Right.
But
so you can get like Hogue or something
Hogue
like that.
Yeah, Hogue or Packmeyer, a $30 grip that this a little has a little sponginess to it that absorbs some of that recoil.
Yeah. Well, my next question is if you have, because she don't, I got a concealed permit, but she don't.
Okay.
Now, if she gets her, I guess I would ask this question. If she goes down and gets her permit, concealed permit, is there any quick, does it make it any quicker for a background check when we purchase?
Yeah.
Or, because I don't remember when
a dealer has the option of using that permit, especially, boy, a brand new one, and using it instead of running the background check through the system. So, you know, at times the system's real slow, times it's really fast, but a dealer can just take that permit and just write down the information off of it and not have to call in and have them run it through.
That is if they opt to do it, but you made a good point, Judge. If you have a new permit or a fairly new permit, and because the date's on there, so they're more apt to use that.
If you got one issued within the last week or two, it's different than one issued several years ago.
Well, I'm not in a hurry. She was just wondering, you know,
because
she don't have a permit. And
may as well go ahead and get it.
Yeah.
Gun in her hand, and I'm going to have her take your class.
May as well go ahead and get it.
Yeah, $20 in 20 minutes down at the sheriff's office is easy to get. And it just
because you don't have to designate what gun you're going to carry, so may as well go ahead and get it.
Yeah, and back to the revolver. We talked about the revolver momentarily ago, and one of the downside of the revolver is it's more difficult to load. Now, you got individuals like Jerry Mitchell, you
and,
know
and
what I'm
you
saying?
Know, the odds are you're not going to have to.
Right, that can speed load that thing. But and those are good things to buy as a speed loader, and I recommend at minimum two speed loaders for a pistol like that. Of course, when you buy that speed loader, you have to buy it for the exact model and make, because the diameter of the wheel, if you will, is greater or smaller depending on the manufacturer and the model type and that kind of thing. But yeah, a speed loader is great, or some people call them moon clips, you know. But yeah, I don't like that term.
I know that you won't need a speed loader, but
well, I was going to say, you know, if you go by the odds, and you want to learn how to shoot it first, you go by the odds, the average gunfight's, you know, 3.5 shots. Well, you know, maybe 3, maybe 4, and most of those will hold 5. But, you know, you might get into one that's 10. But, you know, learn how to shoot it first, and then you'll get into learn how to reload it. They always, I always say the fastest reload on a revolver is another revolver. But I can understand that they seem simpler, and they are simpler. But I tell you, the right kind of semi-auto is so much faster. But, you know, it's personal preference.
It is personal preference. And I think it's just whatever you're comfortable with is smaller. It's easier to probably do conceal. And it's is easier probably to go with that and not have to modify your wardrobe, because when, if you're going to carry concealed, that's a lot of things. That's the thing that people don't understand, that you have to modify your garments, what you wear on a day-to-day basis, to be able to carry concealed and carry comfortably.
Yeah,
and so with that, it becomes a lifestyle change.
They're pretty compact. I wouldn't call them a snub nose, I don't believe, but you shouldn't have to alter the garments that much.
We just don't get the lightest one there is.
No, this one I've seen and I've been looking at is it's all metal. It's all steel. There's no composites or anything like that.
Good, good.
Well, I think that would be
guys,
a good choice.
I appreciate your help, and Judge, it's good talking to you.
And good talking to you, and thank you again for serving with me down there. That was tough.
Not a problem.
All right. Take care.
Bye.
Yeah, that you know, people don't realize that a lot of people think, well, you're a fool for serving on jury duty. They're not fools. They're really doing a service to the community. And some of them are tough. I've had jurors crying after a jury's over, after trial's over with, because they see things that really shake them up. And, you know, some aren't, but a lot of them are. You see a kid that has been, let's say, paralyzed from the neck down, and it's a child that's 8 years old. That's a tough thing to see.
Especially if, you know, on the murder.
Oh, yeah.
Especially someone in the community that was real liked or whatever. And, you know,
and
they seemed like they had everything in the world going for them, and their life was snuffed out by worthless trash.
Right, immediately. Now, you know, a lot of them, frankly, are a lot of victims of crime could just as well be the perpetrator. It's a dope dealer who was shot by his customer or something like that. But a lot of them, and that's probably majority, but when you see good people that are victims of crime, those are the tough ones. Those are really the tough ones. So with that upper there... Mr. Producer, what is our time to the next break? I want to make sure we...
3.5.
All right. Want to remind everybody to call in with questions, comments, 343-0106, area code 251, or text in. But one thing, talking about women and self-defense, is it's not just buying a gun. I mean, that's what a lot of people think. Well, I buy my gun and I'm ready. It's a lifestyle change. It's a situational change. You have to understand awareness. Are you ready to use the gun? Do you know the law? It's a whole different way of life, self-defense is. And that goes regardless of whether you decide, you know, I'm not going to carry a gun, I'm going to carry pepper spray, or I'm going to carry a taser. There are things that you need to know that this isn't rocket science. You can learn it on your own. But we've talked before about situational awareness. Don't come out of the mall staring at your phone, looking at your text messages, or fighting with your child, trying to get them to obey you. You look around and make sure there's not a creepy guy hanging around your car. And if he's creepy looking, you follow your instincts. He probably is a creep. And you just don't go to your car. You circle around and you call the security there at the mall to go with you. Don't be ashamed or don't feel embarrassed by calling somebody. Because most of the time, and one book I want to recommend is a book called The Gift of Fear by Gavin DeBeker. And that's a good book. And it tells you, hey, you listen when your hair stands up on your arm. Don't follow political correctness. Frankly, the odds are if six 18-year-old black kids are following you, and you're an older white woman, you're in some danger. If you're an older woman, black or white, and you've got six elderly men, black or white, following you, you're probably not in any danger. Young people are the ones that tend to commit the crime, and like it or not, young black men in that age range are the prime perpetrators of a lot of those crimes. Political correctness would tell you, I shouldn't have said that, but that's the truth. And you need to learn things like that and get all that political correctness out of your head and understand when you have a sense, you know, that you're in danger, you probably are. And remember, that cell phone, that's not a weapon. That's to call people. And when seconds count, the police are minutes away. And you can't rely. Cell phones are great for a lot of things, but you can't rely on the police to get there and rescue you if you're in the middle of something getting ready to happen. And I think we're about to be pushed off there. Y'all have our number, 343-0106, area code 251. Give us a call with a question, comment, etc. Not just women and self-defense, anything. We'll try to answer it on Armed Alabama, and we'll be stepping into a break and be back on the other side of the break with more of your calls and questions. Remember, we're on Facebook Live right now. Go to the search engine and put in Armed Alabama Radio.
Welcome back to Armed Alabama. Be sure and check us out. Facebook Live. We're broadcasting Facebook Live. And that's Armed Alabama FM Talk 106.5. And if you have any comments or questions, you can give us a call, 251-343-0106, or you can text to the same line. And speaking of text, actually, we got a phone call, Judge.
Yeah, let's take the phone call.
Let's go ahead and take the phone call.
Phone calls over text.
Yeah, so Carl calling in from Theodore. What you got?
Yes, sir, but hey, enjoy your show. Thanks for taking my call, buddy.
Sure, Carl.
Listen, I just not too long ago bought a Parse Judge public defender in Poly. Y'all okay. Familiar with that gun?
Well, I know about the first Taurus Judge that held the 2.5-inch shells, you know, the
That's
full,
what I,
but not I the got, not the yeah. Poly.
Okay, yeah, the Poly is, I think only takes 2.5.
Yeah,
that's what I got.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, that is such a fun little gun to shoot.
Well, I was going to say, mine is too. You know, it'll shoot the .45 long Colt too, and it's pretty darn accurate.
Absolutely.
We shoot trap
shotgun shells are a lot of fun. Especially
I'll tell you a good one. Adam over here was shooting my Judge, and I said, well, we were shooting trap. And I said, let's try something. I've hit 1 out of 100, but I had some numbers, either 7 or 8 shot shells, loaded it up, and my daughter got a picture of him busting a clay pigeon using the Judge, shooting at the clay pigeon with the Judge. And it's a beautiful picture.
It is a deep picture. I got it hanging on the wall.
So try that sometime.
I probably couldn't do that again in 100 years.
I know. It's
a great gun. Let me ask you one more thing quick, and I'll get off.
Yeah.
You know, since it does shoot them 45 long coats so well,
yep.
Heck, I'm thinking about making this an occasional carry gun.
Yeah.
I've got a holster that fits real well in.
Oh, yeah. It's fine. Yeah. It's just not real concealable, but if you're not worried about that, I will tell you that Hornady makes a self-defense round for
you. Beat me to the punch.
Yeah, I'd get those.
I think I've got the Hornady. It's got the little red tips on
there you go.
Yep.
There you go.
Yeah. I just loaded with that, and you're good to go.
I shot a fence post the other day, and it's splattered out, and it looks like a dadgum snowflake or a star.
Yeah. Well, it's fun. Yeah, it's a fun gun,
right,
too. But
hey,
yeah,
thank you so much.
Yeah, good talking to you.
All right, man. Enjoy y'all. Bye.
Hey, Judge, I'd like to ask you a question about that. For those people not familiar with the Judge, because it's kind of a unique weapon, I think.
We're getting ready to tell them.
It fires 410s and 45 longs?
Yes, 410s and 40. You know, I say long Colt just not to confuse people with the 45 ACP automatic. 45 automatic Colt pistol, which mm-hmm. is what goes in a 1911. But actually, it's the original Colt, you know, made in the 1890s or 1880s.
Yeah, you also have the 45 Glock round, too.
Yeah, there are a lot of 45. Yeah. So just to make it easy, 45 long Colt, they are the same diameter, and they will go in the same they'll go in that cylinder. Now, in order for it to be legal, 45, they make several different kinds. Most of them have like a 4-inch barrel or something like that, but they're still rifled. So, you know, the bullet from the 45 long Colt goes out just like a regular bullet, but you can also put in, let's say, buckshot. So it's going to tend to sling that buckshot out of there. It's going to disperse a lot more than, let's say, a shotgun. It's going to stay fairly tight, but it's legal if you do it that way. But they're the exact same size. It'll take – they actually make one now that will take – is it 2 3/4 or 3-inch buckshot in a 410? I can't remember, but – it makes the gun a little odd, but the only thing you gain, I believe, is you go from 3 pellets of buckshot. I know you go to 4, you might get 5, but it's really not worth it.
Yeah, and the self-defense round for those on the buckshot you had mentioned, Judge, they have self-defense round. I think Federal Premium has it or whatever, but there's a jacket in there that keeps those 3 buckshots together.
Pretty tight.
Yeah, and it makes a really tight group.
Yeah, and some people do this, you know, mix and match.
You can,
in 45 long Colt, you could just normally buy the soft lead, the kind of the cowboy. That's a big cowboy action shooting round. But Hornady makes it, it's the hollow point and all. But then the Federal makes it in the self-defense. So it's an interesting gun, and glad it made its comeback. All right, there's Joe. Can't imagine why Joe's calling. Joe on line 2, you're next.
Joe Abdullah.
Yay, Joe. I can actually see your name somehow. I think I must have VSP or something. What's up?
It's all good.
What's up?
I was calling. I can't understand, for the life of me, why you always want to stereotype black people. You say if 6 black guys were walking around the mall or somewhere, and an old white lady walking in front of them, they're up to no good.
No? You know, what did I say?
Racial stereotyping, racial profiling. You know, police do that a lot of times. That's why we're having so much trouble trying to heal these wounds in our community, because people like you, we got that old stereotype stuff in their head, and then you promoting it on the airwaves.
Well, let me tell you what I said. I said,
I know what you said.
No, you repeated it wrong. I said, if you are a woman, doesn't matter, a white woman walking in the street, and they are 6 black guys, 18, 20 years old, following you, you're probably in more danger than you would be if there were 5 or 6 60-year-old white or black men or white or black women. It's the young kids that are more prone to violence, and frankly, it is the young blacks that tend to commit those crimes. That's a fact. Now, like I say, it's you don't have anything to worry about if you got six 35-year-old women following you.
Y'all have nothing to worry about.
What's that?
If you have six young white kids following an old lady, she don't have nothing to worry about.
It depends. Statistically,
see, that's what I'm trying to get you to understand.
Well,
statistically,
you do not have as much worry about, because the incidence of blacks committing crimes against whites is about 12 times more than whites committing crimes against blacks. But I will tell you, it depends on where you are. If you're, what I was trying to point out too, if the hairs on your arm goes up, you better be concerned. I don't care who's following you.
But you use the example, and you stereotype the young black man.
Because statistically, you're in more danger from them.
That's stereotyping. That's racial profiling. That's what the
true.
Police do a lot of times.
Yeah, but it's true.
So many problems we're having in the community with the police and the community.
But
because
if it's true,
how many years were you a judge?
True. Listen, if it's true, Joe, why shouldn't I tell it to people?
It's true to you. You can screw statistics to look any kind of way.
I've looked at the statistics. It's true.
You can screw to. I also remember you saying one day, you say, "Yeah, majority of the black on black crime, black on black crime." You live in a certain area, more like the crime you commit gonna be on the one that live in your neighborhood. Same thing with white people. You live around white people, they're gonna commit crime on white people. But you don't ever hear anything talking about white on white crime.
Well, because black on black crime is about 10 times higher.
I can't understand how you ever became a judge.
It is.
You're telling on yourself.
It is true, Joe. If you don't believe that, you're in a fantasy land.
No, you're in a fantasy land.
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you think, Joe, listen to me now. We've got cut you down so I can ask you a question. Do you think that the crime rate is just as high in white neighborhoods? And if it is, what's happening with all the people who have been assaulted and murdered? Are the white people just hiding those bodies in order to keep them out of the press or out of the statistics? Okay, go ahead.
It's more white people getting killed in America than it is black. We're only 14% of the population.
Well,
that's... So how you going to sit there and say majority of people getting killed in America is black?
No, I didn't say that.
We're only 14% of the population.
Joe, let me cut you down again. I just asked you, you said there were just as many white neighborhoods, just as many whites committing crimes against other whites. If that's true, because the statistics don't show it, where are the bodies? Where are all the murder victims? Where are all the assault victims? Are they being hidden? Because it's kind of hard to hide somebody's body, but maybe that's happening. Okay, quick, you got 1 minute. Go ahead.
For the life of me, and you was a judge all these years, and you still want to raise a profile and spread the prejudice in this community. It's just astonishing to me.
Well, you need to read the statistics, and you would understand it.
Statistics can be skewed, and I read statistics.
Okay.
And I don't agree with your analogy of none of those statistics.
Okay. Got to run to a break, but I do thank you for calling in. Do thank you for calling in, Joe. Take care. All right. Our number here is 251-343-0106. We're on Facebook Live. That is Armed Alabama FM, Armed Alabama Radio FM 106.5. We'll go to the break. We have kept Dennis on the line, who is down in beautiful, beautiful Orange Beach. Not sure if sir is beautiful tonight, but Dennis, how are you?
Just and actually dry right now. So,
well, let me ask you: have you got any murder victims laying around, and are y'all hiding them in order that your statistics will not be as high as they are in the inner cities?
If we are, we're hiding them really well.
Good, good. Keep it up.
That last caller did bring up one thought. You know, sometimes the truth is just not very convenient.
Yeah, I'm afraid so. And listen, I want things to get better, but until you recognize what's going on, they're not going to get better.
You got it. You have to be honest with yourself.
Right. What's up?
What I thought about was one of the calls earlier I heard, the guy that was talking about the revolvers, and y'all kind of got talking about concealed carry.
Yep.
If he's still listening, and then for other people that are listening that haven't done it, if you're going to conceal carry, sometimes you have wardrobe changes, but one change I would highly suggest is when you decide to conceal carry, go ahead and get a real gun belt, not just a leather belt from the clothing store.
You know, I probably look like a nerd, but what I wore every day when I was on the bench is, and they make dress ones, it was nice looking, but it was a leather and Kevlar belt that, it was a police belt, but leather and Kevlar, and it looked like any belt that you would wear with a dress suit, but somebody would have, and then, of course, I wore a level 3 retention holster, Blackhawk, or I can't remember the manufacturer. Somebody would have to drag me away with it if they wanted to snatch my gun. And, it's really not that much more than a good quality real leather belt, but very few stores sell real leather belts. Most of them are junk from China.
Yeah, they are.
So, that's an excellent point because your holster's only as good as your belt. And the other thing is buy a good quality holster. A $9.99 holster just isn't going to get it. I mean, you ought to spend probably minimum $40 to get a good quality holster.
At minimum.
Yeah. And we got whole boxes of holsters, both of us.
I think anybody that has carried very long probably has more than one box.
Right.
And then once you do all that, empty it, make sure it's empty it, double check it, triple check it, and actually practice drawing from it.
And another thing, and you being at the beach presents a unique problem too. But, wear different kind of clothes and practice drawing from it. Everybody practices in the same thing, pants, a shirt tucked in, and that's it. Put an overcoat on and make sure you know how to draw it. Raincoat, or in your case, what do you do when you've got short pants on?
Or Speedos.
Yes, I wasn't going to say that.
Let's hope not.
But, different wardrobe. Nobody does that. Nobody.
Right.
A few people do that. But, you got to be thinking ahead with it. I even practiced I had an old robe, and I'd go probably every other month, and I had kind of a simulated bench, and I'd push back with the chair, and I'd go down and use the bench kind of as a brace, because I carried a full-size Beretta M9, and use the bench kind of to steady myself. But otherwise, I couldn't have drawn from, with a robe that goes almost to the floor. That would have been real tough. If you don't practice, you're not going to be able to do it.
Yeah, I just wanted to take Paul's head out there and thank you all very much.
Thank you. Appreciate you calling.
Appreciate it, Dennis. That was a good call, some good questions and good comments that Dennis had. Yep. So next caller is T, is from Mobile.
Hope it's not Mr. T.
Hello?
We're in trouble.
No, you're not. You're doing great. I got a fast question, then I'll hang up. What's your opinion on a Mini 14?
I love them. I've got one, so...
When I was in Vietnam, I had regular M14, and I didn't have the M16, we had the M14,
right.
And that outshot the other gun, you wouldn't believe me, okay?
Yep.
And I miss it, but,
kind of like classics,
bought me
I can tell.
Mini 14, and I'm going to get off the phone, because my minutes are running out, and I'll listen to you on the radio. I'd like to have your opinion, and
sure.
It shoots a 223 Remington,
right.
Okay?
Well, right.
I'll hear you on the radio.
I'll talk about it. The only problem with the that's a Ruger Mini 14 is 10 years ago when you bought a Mini 14, there was a Mini 14 that you bought. Now they make about 10 or 12 different models.
Yeah, variations.
And what you could buy 10 years ago is a nice wooden gun, semi-auto, that you could, you know, it has an external magazine that would hold 10 or 20 rounds. And I think the variation would be either blue or black steel, blue or stainless steel.
Stainless steel, yeah.
And it's a good gun, but it's a classic, a wood gun, as opposed to a black rifle. Now, though, they make a lot of different versions of it, and they may, I'm almost certain they make it in a couple of different calibers now, which even confuses. But they're good, high-quality guns, especially for people that kind of like the classic look. And there's some people that kind of get scared. My daughter has got an M1 carbine, and the reason, now, believe me, she's not going out shooting it by herself. She didn't love them. But she's more prone to shoot the gun because of the wood. It doesn't look like a scary, you know, AR, the black rifle that is to some people intimidating. But Ruger Mini 14, I think it's a good choice, you know, depending on what you want it for.
Yeah, I would agree, definitely. And there's, I don't think so much now, but, you know, 20 years ago, there was a lot of a highway patrol that would carry the full select fire version that would actually fire not only the 223, but the 5.56 NATO as well.
You're right.
With the increased chamber pressures. They loved them. And I heard from several officers over the years that they hated giving it up going to the AR platform. You know?
I know that I've got a couple of Ruger pistols. And when I've needed a little work done on them, they have been really efficient. They have sent a mailing label over the internet, picked them up at the house, and I've had them back in a week. So from that standpoint, they've been very efficient, and they're an American company. So they're a good company.
Judge, we got some really good questions and comments on the text line here. The first one I'm going to get to is somebody texts in and says, I keep hearing from other CCW carriers, which is concealed carry weapons permit, is what he's referring to, who were licensed in Baldwin County, that you cannot carry with a round in the chamber.
Well, that is not true.
Exactly.
And I would tell you the opposite. You should never – don't carry your gun if you're not going to carry one with a round in the chamber. Because there's no way on earth you could possibly be in a situation to defend yourself if you have to rack the slide. We're talking about semi-auto now. If you have to rack the slide, because a gunfight or an attack is not going to happen by somebody calling you out and playing by the rules. Criminals don't play by the rules. The attack may take place when you're walking down the street. And next thing you know, somebody kicks you in the small of the back and knocks you to the ground, and you're dazed, and you think you're going to be able to rack the slide on the gun and turn over and fire a shot.
Well, it's not just that. It's drawing the pistol.
Right.
You know, while you're on the ground with your cover
garments.
One more
step.
Yeah, absolutely. And then you have to rack the slide on top of that. So good point, Judge.
Unless you're buying something from China that we're not going to be importing anymore, thank goodness. Most of the guns that I'm aware of that are made in America since 2000, they're all safe to have a round in the chamber. And I say 2000, you're really probably from 85 on. They drop test them from, I think it's 18 feet. They will not go off. And they go off when people draw them and put their fingers on the trigger. You got to learn to index your finger just under the slide on the firearm and not put your finger inside the trigger guard.
Yeah.
But no, that is, I don't know who's spreading that. But
I hadn't heard that one before from saying this Baldwin County.
The worst.
But you
device.
And I have heard before, it was like, I'm just not comfortable carrying a round in the chamber. And we've heard that before.
I can understand that. It's just they have to be explained the mechanics of it and why it cannot go off. And that's something we may need to put on the YouTube channel, showing a gun drop tested.
Right.
That would be a good one to show. And
All right, welcome back to the second hour of Armed Alabama, the two-hour show from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. on self-defense, firearm ammo selection, home protection, concealed carry, training, proper range etiquette, and, of course, the law. Alabama law, Mississippi law, and Florida law, and the U.S. Constitution, courtesy of retired Judge Rusty Johnson. Glad you can join us, or glad you could hang in with us here for a second hour of the show. If you have a comment or a question, be sure and call us at 251-343-0106. And we're also broadcasting on Facebook Live. You can go to our Facebook page, Armed Alabama Radio, FM Talk 106.5, and you can join the conversation there. A lot of people commenting there, asking questions, and we're answering those live on Facebook. You can also check us out on Armed Alabama Twitter account and the Armed Alabama YouTube page. So go to that Armed Alabama YouTube page there and like and subscribe. There's lots of good videos that we have, and we all have all of our previous Facebook Live broadcasts on our YouTube account. And if you can't check us out, or if you don't catch the whole show during our Tuesday night broadcast, be sure and go to our website, armedalabama.com, and you can go there and listen to all of our previous shows on podcast and listen to them at work. A lot of people comment to me all the time, hey, I can't catch your show in its entirety on Tuesday nights, but I always check it out on your website. So be sure and check us out. You can also listen to us on your smartphone, on the app there on your smartphone, and that is the TuneIn app. It's a good app there, and you can check us out. Anyway, glad you can check us out on a second hour of the show. Judge, you and I have talked several times this week, just texting back and forth, and tonight, about the lawsuit that was filed against Trump's order. And you got a unique perspective as a retired judge,
yeah,
that probably most of us don't have.
Well, number one, this is the lawsuit, which is somewhat unprecedented, because generally you give the commander-in-chief, the president, total authority to decide who enters the country and on a temporary basis. He entered an order which was exact same order from the same countries that President Obama did 2 years ago. Nobody said anything about that. But irregardless of that, this lawsuit was filed Friday afternoon, and they had the hearing at 3 o'clock Pacific time with a senior status judge in the Western District, U.S. District Court, Western District of Washington State. It's a federal court. My philosophy was, anytime anyone filed a temporary restraining order on a Friday afternoon, they were trying to pull something. They didn't want the other side to have time to prepare. Something was going on. In this case, the order had been in effect a week. They certainly could have filed it the day before. And then to have a senior status judge happen to catch that case, the ratio usually is they get 1/4 or 1/8 of the civil cases that the other judges get. He just happened to get it, and he just happened to be in his prior life someone who volunteered to work at an agency that defended aliens and refugees. That was a real coincidence. I watched the hearing. The arguments made by the plaintiffs, that one of which was Washington State, the lawyers couldn't have been poorer. I mean, it was like watching a lawyer right out of law school try a dog bite case in my court. It was terrible. And the judge wasn't, frankly, much better. And what do you know? He ruled in favor of the state, and now about 14 states have joined with Washington State. I don't think they even have standing to even file such a lawsuit. So the Nutty Ninth Circuit heard oral arguments ending about an hour ago. I say Nutty Ninth. I mean, what kind of circuit court of appeals would say you have to take under God out of the Pledge of Allegiance? That is among a lot of other, the most reversed circuit by the U.S. Supreme Court of any. And a three-judge panel of that group heard oral arguments ending about an hour ago. My prediction is they will not reverse the U.S. district judge, and technically this is that order is only good for 14 days, but this is an outrage. It's the reason why I've said we're never going to defeat the progressives by out-appointing to the federal bench conservative judges. That's never going to work. What we need to do is strip the jurisdiction away from those courts that Congress gave them that isn't called for in the Constitution. Congress gradually, over the years, expanded the jurisdiction of those courts, and they can take it away from them. And they need to do that. They don't need to be deciding every social issue that comes along. They practically decide every issue that comes along now. And the framers and the ratifiers considered that. And they didn't want that. They didn't want them to be deciding and destroy the state court system. And that's what they've done. And so maybe this will be the impetus that pushes people to do that. We need to do something, because for them to decide these major policy issues constantly is not what the framers and the ratifiers had in mind. Absolutely the opposite.
You're talking about the framers of the Constitution?
Yeah. I'll say the framers are the ones that drafted it in Philadelphia,
mm-hmm.
and then the ratifiers were the ones in the state constitutional conventions that ratified it for their individual states, just to make that clear.
Yeah, and they wrangled and argued back and forth.
And there are records of that.
Yep.
And there are records of what they meant. And one thing Madison wanted to do, because Madison wasn't necessarily a good guy when things got started, he wanted the federal government to have a veto over all state laws passed by the state legislators. And he was voted down. They said, no, that's in Philadelphia. No way. We're not going to do that. That would destroy the power of the states. He wanted to have a panel composed of the executive, a few members of the legislative branch, and a few members of the judicial branch. Every state law, review it, decide whether it was good or bad, and to strike it down. No, we're not going to have that. Well, that's what we have now. We have the same thing now.
In that sense.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's come around to the same thing. And all it would take is an act of Congress to repeal, well, the Judiciary Act, whatever the current code section is, I can't remember, of 1789, Section 25, and take away the jurisdiction of the U.S. District Courts to hear cases and controversies involving the constitutional laws of the U.S. that they were just given in 1875. So there are ways to take care of it and not have government by the judiciary, which we certainly have now. Everyone runs to the courts instead of their legislatures. That's where the laws should be made. You got a couple of texts there?
Yeah, I was just looking over these texts real quick before we go to the break. We're on our text line here. One of them is, let's see, Judge, can I have my home defense shotgun in my truck legally? And that is a...
Yes.
Mossberg Maverick,
yes.
With the 18.5-inch barrel.
The law says pistol. When it says what you have to have a permit for, it is a pistol in your automobile. It doesn't – shotgun, you're fine. Yeah.
All right, good. That's going to clarify, I think, for a lot of people. All right, we'll have this and much more when we come back. This is Armed Alabama. All right, welcome back to Armed Alabama. We still got plenty of show left. 2-hour show from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And we talked self-defense, firearm ammo selection, concealed carry, home protection, and much, much more, including the law. So, Judge, I think we had a question right before we went to break. It was about the carrying his Mossberg shotgun in his truck legally, and that was with an 18.5-inch barrel, and we was actually trying to find the code,
which is a legal limit on the size of the barrel.
Yeah, that 18.5-inch is the legal limit.
Actually, it's 18, but everybody gives it a little extra,
yeah.
Just in case.
Just in case, absolutely.
I don't,
And I actually have
13A1175 permit to carry in a says permit to carry pistol in vehicle or concealed on person. The sheriff of a county upon the application of any person residing in that county, blah, 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 blah. But it requires a permit to carry a pistol, pistol in a vehicle or concealed on your person. And now, well, the judge is a pistol. It's not a shotgun. I was trying to play games here. But you don't have to answer his question, you don't have to have a permit to carry a long gun in your vehicle.
Yeah, I actually have a Mossberg Maverick shotgun, the little, it's probably the same one he's got. So it's got a special purpose barrel on it. It's a pretty good little shotgun. And what I like about the Maverick versus the regular Mossberg is that the safety is on the trigger group and not on top of the receiver. Which can be a little bit awkward to try to reach up there with your thumb,
yeah,
and operate the safety on and off on top of the receiver. So your trigger finger is already indexed along the side of the frame if you're keeping your finger off the trigger. So it's just so easy to turn that safety on and off.
Yeah, and what you're saying, because I have the traditional Mossberg, it is on top of the frame.
Yep, on top of the receiver.
Yeah, and it's like a switch almost.
Yeah.
And it's the only shotgun really I've ever seen like that, and it's just different.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing wrong with it either way.
If you're going to use it, you got to get used to it.
You have to
get
used to it and practice. Yeah, I've also got
What do you think the penalty is for carrying a concealed weapon in Alabama without a permit?
It's a misdemeanor crime, right?
It is a Class B misdemeanor,
yeah.
And it is up to 6 months in the county jail and up to a $500 fine. So it is severe.
Mm-hmm.
And my point is, it's really old, and they've never updated it. But the crime itself is that a person who carries concealed about his person a Bowie knife or knife or instrument of like kind – or pistol or firearm of any other kind, and by the way, or air gun, now this is all concealed, shall be fined less than. Now, how you would carry anybody has ever released a real Bowie knife, they're almost like a machete, a little shorter, but probably got, I don't know, an 8-inch, 10-inch blade on them. I guess it's possible with an overcoat or something, but that's the offense. But then later, the permit is to have one in a vehicle. So you're all right to carry a long gun in a vehicle. Now, you remember the days, of course, when everybody that had a pickup had a shotgun and a rack in the back window. That stopped mainly because people want to keep their shotguns and not have them stolen.
That was a common sight.
Oh, everybody.
25 years ago,
yeah.
it was a common sight.
When I think about it now, I'm just amazed. But nobody bothered to steal their guns. And they would be stolen just like that now. I don't care where you parked it. I mean, you can't even park some cars in a nice area with, let's say, a mink coat in it without it getting stolen. I mean, can you imagine somebody that foolish
you think?
To leave a mink coat in a car? They deserve to have it stolen.
All right, Judge. Got a few more texts here. That was one. Some other ones were just saying that they liked your comments earlier regarding the statistics. One of the things that you were trying to comment.
Bureau of Justice Statistics, www.bj, Bureau of Justice, bjs.gov. If you want to look at all of those,
yeah, I want to point out that those were government statistics that you were commenting about. Also, is you were commenting about
now they could be fake too, but they're still from the
government.
Government.
Yeah, just look at the climate change website the government had previously.
Real phony.
So, what you wanted to comment earlier is be sure and listen to that inner voice. That's the main thing. If you're in a dark alley or whatever and something doesn't look right, doesn't feel right,
I don't care if there are five people following you, hear that little voice. Baptist preachers. If
yeah.
If you feel that voice saying you're in danger, you run from them. Don't take any chances.
Yeah, and that's a good comment, and that's something that we always tell everybody is be sure and listen to that inner voice.
Just because you've had drilled into you, don't play the stereotype game. You play whatever game you need to save yourself.
All right, Judge, we got a call online. Danny's calling from Mobile. Hi, Danny, what you got?
Hi, how you doing tonight?
Fine,
doing
how
great.
About you?
All right. Hey, Judge, first of all, I used to work for you at the courthouse.
Oh, yeah.
I'm now a police officer from Mobile.
Great.
And I know it's a firearm show, but you brought up the statute there about Bowie knives, and you're talking about the links.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, that statute used to read, I'm an edge weapons instructor, so I kind of keep up on those. But that statute actually used to read any fixed blade knife of Bowie-like design.
Well, it still does.
5 inches or longer.
It still does.
It does? Okay.
Yeah, let me get back to it.
What was
kinda
that? 13A1150?
Yeah, it says, except as otherwise provided in this code, a person who carries concealed about his person a Bowie knife or instrument of like kind or description. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So what they did was they left out the, like I said, one time, it's been a while back, but one time it actually said of 5 inches or larger. And a lot of people don't know that Bowie knives, even though Bowie knives, like you said, are characteristically 8 inches or even up to 13 inches and larger, Bowie knife design, just the blade itself, the blade design, you can get those in 5 and 6 inch lengths, which are very concealable.
Yeah.
But it still would, of course, I don't know with that new statute now that they left out the measurement rule that may negate that altogether.
I see where, you can see they don't tell you what they did, but it has a long string of when it was amended at some point. You know, the original section is from 1852, and I see where it has been amended at least since 75, and probably a lot more recently. It's just the code is 75, so that's probably when it happened.
Okay.
But what the traditional Bowie knife? What's the blade on it?
Yeah, they're kind of hard to conceal. You're right.
Yeah. What would you say the blade on? Just I mean the traditional Bowie knife.
Well, the traditional Bowie knife started out at 9 inches.
Okay.
Characteristically, they were around. They usually, at least on the frontier time, the frontier days, they were usually characteristic on an average of about 13.
Wow. Yeah.
But 9 inches was considered small because most of your, if you go a little bit further back than say the 1800s,
yeah,
the average person, average frontiersman carried basically nothing more than a butcher knife, and those butcher knives were as long as 6, 7, and 8 inches long.
Wow.
It was an all-around knife. I mean, it was a one-tool option.
Yeah.
But in the 1800s, when they started, those Bowie knives started becoming, because of Jim Bowie, and they started becoming more known for its fighting capabilities, I guess you could say.
Right.
They started lengthening the blades on them, and 13 inches was considered characteristic.
Would you do something? Would you drop me an email, thejudge@armedalabama.com, because I may need you kind of as a resource, if you don't mind, since you're a knife
again,
person.
Judge?
The Judge at armedalabama.com. All one string. The Judge at armedalabama.com.
I sure will.
Just drop me an email.
I sure will,
all right.
Judge.
Appreciate it. Take care.
Take care.
Most guys my age carry a pocket knife. Are we in trouble?
You're in trouble, definitely, because there's a rule about people who are non-compos mentis being a little out of it.
And working radio.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. But
that's prima facie evident.
Average pocket knife is okay.
No, yeah, the 2-inch, 2.5-inch, 3-inch blade pocket knife, you're fine.
Good.
All right, we got another caller, Williams, calling from 8 Mile. Hey, William. Whoop. Maybe he wasn't.
they had a trial in U.S. District Court one time. Involved, everybody was from Washington County. They had a box full of knives that probably had 300 knives in there from all the spectators coming because everybody brought their knives with them.
Somebody might have taken home the wrong knife.
Yeah, exactly.
Know. What were they? They just collected as they come into the courtroom?
Yeah, because they didn't know you couldn't bring your knife with you. And so they all just brought their knives. Now, this was before 9/11 when it was a little laxer. But everybody had a knife on them. So probably ought to, if William is listening, we're right up against a break. William, we'll grab you. Well, we got...
got a minute. We might be able to catch him.
Adam, you give it a try while I finish looking this up.
Hey, William, you're on Armed Alabama. What you got? Quickly.
I've got a problem I've had for a little over a year. There's a drug rehab center, West Mobile.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
And when they have any kind of problem with any of their people that are in there, they take them and load them up in a van and dump them out. I heard you talking about Walmart a while ago. They dump them out at Walmart parking lot at Airport and Schillinger's.
There you go.
And just leave them. And after they drop them out, then they call somebody to come get them. And I've been arguing with them. I try to be polite, and I tell them, look, y'all need to call somebody before, you know, to you dump them out. And that's because if they dump out people out of drug rehab, it's about 98 degrees last summer when they did it to my friend. And there's going to be car burglaries or purse snatchings. You just can't dump them people out. And
you know what
no
I'm going to do?
No water, nothing.
I'm going to think about somebody. I just can't think it up right now. Those people, they couldn't operate without getting money from both the state and the federal government. I'm going to think of who you can call to really cause them some grief. Because
I have called Rusty Glover.
Yeah, but I want you to call the people that are getting them the money.
And Connie Hudson flat out told me that them people can roam wherever they want to roam.
Well, I understand that, but they can't be – they're getting paid money by the federal government and the state government. And if we can find the right button for you to press,
right?
Like who's ever financing them, and we find out that that's what they're doing because they're still charging whomever – you can bust them, but I just can't think of it right now. Keep listening, and I tell you what, why don't you, do you have email?
No, so I don't even know how to turn a computer on.
That's all right. Hey, listen the rest of the night, but better next week. I'm going to probably have to look it up. Listen next
all
week,
right.
And I'll give you some info on who to call.
Okay.
All right, you take care. We're going to step into a break here with Armed Alabama, and we'll be right back after the break. We have on the line, this is Judge Rusty Johnston. Welcome back to Armed Alabama. And we have on the line Michael, who's calling us from the People's Republic of California. Michael, how are you?
I'm doing okay. How are you guys doing?
Pretty good. Whereabouts are you out there? I know you've moved out there, but what part of California?
Yes, it's down in Orange County, just south of L.A.
Oh, wow. I had an opportunity of a lifetime that didn't quite develop, but I researched the weapons laws out there too, and saying I could hardly believe it is an understatement. For instance, I concluded that the Mace pepper spray gun was legal, but not the Kimber pepper sprayer, and of course my tactical baton was illegal. So tell me what you've concluded, because I think you've been trying to figure out what you could do to protect yourself. Of course, they don't issue concealed carry permits unless you're a friend of is it the sheriff that issues them?
I'm not sure. I haven't even figured it out. There's so much legal red tape out here. It is crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're like one of the things that apparently that the firearms manufacturers have to do in order to sell new firearms, I think they have to submit four handguns, right?
Yeah, prototypes.
The number that they want to sell to the California Department of Justice every single year, and they call it the happy list. And if a gun is not on the happy list, you can't purchase it.
Okay.
And one of the things that they did last year, for instance, is now we have to go through background checks in order just to purchase ammunition.
That's what I heard. That is just so outrageous. I cannot believe it.
Yeah, Michael, that was part of a new law that California initiated, and the governor signed it into effect, along with also, wasn't it some type of assault weapons ban or something like that is what they called it?
Yeah, so it's pretty much, it sounds like just incrementalism, where before you could have either an AK or an AR-15 or any other semi-automatic rifle, pretty much, you could have a bullet button on it, right? And it had to be, you know, I think the magazine capacity was limited to either 5 or 10 rounds. And now what they said is that any rifle that has a bullet button can no longer be transferred in the state of California. Huh. So basically what it means is if your father has one, right, an AR-15 or an AK-47 with this bullet button on it that was legal last year in California, and he passes away, he cannot leave that to you in his will.
Good God. You know,
it then has to be taken to the gun shop, basically, and it's got to be auctioned off and sold out of state.
You know, that is a formula for ruining a state. And I'm sure it's really reduced the crime there.
So, oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, because it's all the bad guys, you know, make sure that they pay attention to all the laws.
Yeah, you know.
Well, that's what it does. You know, that's a good point, Michael. The bad guys are the one that have the guns, and the law-abiding citizens have no way to acquire the firearms to defend themselves or the ammunition.
Right.
Apparently, Michael, they have a law that if you have children under a certain age in the house, you have to have the firearm locked securely so they can't access it. And, you know, on first blush, that sounds good, but I think it's like up to 14. And they had a case out there a few years ago where the children who were like, you know, 12 and 13 were very proficient in the use of the firearms. And a lunatic came in when the parents were gone. The guns were locked up. He killed both children with a pitchfork. You know, they could not get to the firearms. And so, you know, that they are martyrs to some stupid law like that. You know, there are more kids that are killed by automobiles, hit by automobiles, or drowning than there are accidentally by firearms. But, you know, firearms are the bad guys.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So, well, we wish you luck out there. Keep listening to us.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I pay attention to you guys every week as much as I can, and I try to tell some of my friends out here, too.
Yeah, maybe we can convert a few. You know, to show you the difference, you saw that mess at Berkeley. When Reagan was governor in 66 or 67, it must have been, they did something similar, rioting like that. He had the California Highway Patrol open up on them with buckshot, and that stopped that rioting. You know, cleared it out. It killed a couple of them, but it stopped their rioting. And he went to the Board of Trustees meeting at that school and blasted them for allowing students at that school to look like that and act like that. And that shows you how far we've gone.
Michael, how are you listening to us? You listen on Facebook Live or through the TuneIn app or what?
Yes, it was on Facebook Live, actually.
Good.
Well, great. We appreciate you listening from all the way from Orange County, California.
Yes, sir. I appreciate you guys and everything that you guys do.
Well, stay safe.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you so much. That means a lot. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and in Berkeley, before they were taking a vacant lot that the hippies had turned into a dope park, and they were building a parking garage. Well, they had a sit-in. They had, you know, all kind of stuff. And finally, they took over the administration building, you know, the whole thing, and, you know, basically had a nightly riot. So Reagan, with his chief aide, Ed Meese, he sent in the California Highway Patrol, and when they attacked the Highway Patrol, he authorized them to use shotguns with buckshot, and that stopped that nonsense. But Reagan, he was the, you know, chairman of the board, ex officio. And he turned red and he said, "This all started when you let these kids know they could get away with all this irresponsible actions, I mean, he let them have it.
Yeah, but you do know, Judge, that the best and the brightest go to Berkeley.
Yeah, and
somebody,
I understand.
Just ask them, they'll tell
they
you.
They go and they never graduate.
But I heard some spokesman say that about Berkeley. And I remember during Vietnam, you know, at Southern Miss, panty raid was our big protest.
Yeah.
But they were burning the campus down.
Oh, the kooks were. Yeah. And apparently they still are.
Maybe it's their children.
Yeah. Well, pop another, some more texts that we need to get to.
Otherwise, yeah, I was just going to follow up. I was going to follow up on what Michael said.
Let me mention about the pepper spray, because when I was researching that, that's how I got onto McCoy's selling the Mace brand pepper spray. It looks like, and it's, oddly enough, why would it be legal to have the Mace brand pepper spray, which has the canister, and not to have the Kimber pepper spray? I don't know, but Mace brand pepper spray with the gun is legal out there. And thing I like about it is it looks like a flare gun where it breaks open. You can put water canisters in it to practice, because you need to know about how far it shoots. When it has the pepper spray in it, you have 6 to 8 2-second shots of pepper spray. So if you've got multiple attackers or you miss, and it will go at least 15 feet, you know, if you don't have any wind or anything, maybe even 18 feet. And you ought to wear it, should wear it. You don't have to, but you should, in a holster right where you would wear a gun, so you can draw it pretty quick. And if you've got somebody charging you, it'll take them down. And watch some of these rioters at Trump's inauguration get hit with pepper spray. You'll see them go to the ground crying like a baby. It is the rare sight where somebody doesn't bother them. There are people that get shot multiple times that aren't bothered. So there are exceptions to every rule. But if you don't want to carry or can't carry a gun, next thing is I would go with that Mace pepper spray gun, and certainly do not go with bear spray, wasp, or hornet spray. Those don't do anything.
Yeah, and you can get that Mace pepper spray gun at McCoy Outdoors.
That's right.
And
the only store in town that sells it, actually.
I don't think I've seen it anywhere else except for there. And those guys and gals know about everything that's in that store.
Do.
I mean, you could spend an hour or so in there and not see everything that they have.
Mobile owned and operated. Easy to get to. You don't have to go to the mall. There's Spring Hill Avenue right as I-65 passes over Spring Hill Avenue in the Spring Hill Avenue Shopping Center and the OK&B store.
Yeah, and they're not going to tell you wrong. They know the products and the items there that they have for sale, and that Mace pepper spray is just one of the many items that they have that we recommend. So be sure and check out McCoy Outdoors. Check out them online. They're also on Facebook page, McCoy Outdoors, Inc. So be sure
remember to
check
like
them
their
out.
Page.
Yep. And like the judge said, they're just west of the I-65 interstate there on Spring Hill Avenue. So be sure and check out McCoy Outdoors. Still more show left on Armed Alabama. All right, welcome
Shoot,
back.
Shoot, I felt like I'd have a pretty good time in Vegas with all that stuff.
I thought we were saying the Democratic Convention.
Yeah, that's right.
Huh? All right, welcome back to Armed Alabama. Glad you could hang with us. We still got a little bit more left of the show. We've got plenty of texts that we hadn't even got to yet, and we also have a caller. Josh is calling from Wilmer, Alabama. Welcome to Armed Alabama, Josh.
How y'all doing, guys?
Doing well. What you got?
Well, I want to get a little information on the HPA, the Hearing Protection Act. I know it's been tossed around, and with Trump being in office, I heard it was reintroduced to Congress this month, and kind of want to get some insight on it, and if it passes, what it means for us as hunters and recreational shooters and suppressors in general.
Oh, you mean the Assassin Act. You know, that's for everybody that doesn't know what we're talking about. This is to make suppressors, which we would call them, commonly people call them silencers, but they're not silencers. They're suppressors that reduce the sound from a firearm, certain number of decibels. I don't want to guess. So you'd have to look at each individual's. But it's a good idea because it helps the environment, helps your neighbor. They never reduce. Maybe a 22, you could short subsonic, you know, it would reduce it so nobody could hear it. But, you know, other than that, it doesn't reduce 9 millimeters, so you could sneak up behind somebody and assassinate them, and nobody's going to hear it because, number one, that bullet's going to break the sound barrier, which is always right. going to cause a crack. But right. one thing is that shooting ranges, hunters, everybody are getting increased pressure from folks who complain about noise as cities grow out. That would cause an end to that problem. But, yeah, I know it's been introduced. I know it hasn't had hearings or anything because Congress has just gone back in session. But, you know, the problem I see is, I'll just say it, like, we have so many wuss congressmen who don't even think close to what Trump thinks like that I hope they can be made to see the light. But you see on this simple immigration order, the minute the heat gets put on them, they all run for cover.
And, yeah, you know. And going back to the Hearing Protection Act, what I read is, you know, I know you got to do the $200 tax stamp for a silencer right now, a suppressor, excuse me.
Yeah.
What the HPA introduces, you know, anybody, if it passes, anybody after 2015, of October of 2015, they get a refund on their tax, their tax. And the way you can get one from there on after is, you know, just like I go buy a long arm, a long rifle, I got to fill out a background check. You know, and like you said, it doesn't silence the firearm, but it does reduce the sound.
Right,
and,
tremendously.
Yeah, and I've shot them before, and I'm going to tell you what, you know, even when you do break the sound barrier, you know, over 1,200 feet per second, you don't get the crack right there at you. You know, it's
right.
20 yards out, so, you know, it could be shot without hearing protection, and I think that would be helpful for a lot of people. I'm pumped about it if it passes.
Well, I am too, because the thing about it is, we talk about McCoy Outdoors, they've got a huge selection of suppressors there, and I just can't wait to get my hands on one if
well,
that passes.
Well, one problem is that you know, you have to get it approved, you have to buy the stamp. You may buy it, and it may be several months before you ever take possession.
You'll be lucky if you get it in 90 days.
Yeah, and that's just crazy. Because mainly a myth. I mean, it's bad.
I think it'd be great for recreational guys, too. Like, you're talking about shooting ranges. And think about kids that, you know, like my kids shoot 22s for me. How fun would that be to say, you know what, you know, let's go shooting. And you're talking about shooting a standard velocity or a subsonic round that's close to a pellet gun going off. That'd be great.
Let me give you the act number so you can kind of follow it. It is H.R. 367, that's, you know, in the House, and the bill in the Senate, the number is S-59. So in the House, it is, and it's got a long name, but it's H.R. 367, and then the Senate number is S-59.
Okay. Well, guys, I don't want to take up too much of your time. I really enjoy your show. I like to call every chance I get. It's my second time calling, and I've gotten through both times. So
good.
I'm glad y'all got this show going on, and like I said, I really enjoy it. So
thank you. Appreciate it.
Appreciate it, Josh. Thank you for your phone call.
Yeah, I'm glad he brought that up.
It is. I'm excited about it. I mean, I probably haven't been this excited about
a
firearm bill or anything else like that.
We talk
in a
about
while.
Just, you know, myths and things out there. It's just a myth. And that ought to be done away with. It's causing needless expense.
No one ever talks about it from a sense of noise pollution. I mean, you take your family out to the firearm range, and you know, children and your wife, very apprehensive when the guns go off and the big bang and so forth.
And you're still probably losing hearing because you're really supposed to wear, in addition to earmuffs that we all wear, earplugs too.
Exactly.
You're still losing. I've lost enough to where it doesn't matter.
What?
But yeah, exactly. And
what'd you say?
That's just crazy.
All right, some more text here. Some people commenting is that, what about the Bowie knives? One comment is from Calvin is, what about the Rambo knife with a compass?
Well, I'm not sure what a Rambo knife is, but if you're getting up in that, you know, 7-inch, 8-inch range, I would be concerned about
carrying. And that is carrying at that range, yeah.
Yeah, I would be concerned about carrying it concealed. Compass or no compass, actually, because I don't think the compass matters.
Well, you can find your way out of Walmart with
yeah,
the compass.
Yeah, I think so. I think so. The thing is, I would not depend on a knife. I know somebody that went to a week-long knife fighting school, spent a lot of money, came back, and he concluded, I think I'm going to keep using my pistol for self-defense. I concluded the same thing. Yeah, because it is a very difficult art, and it is an art to master, and most people are never going to put in the time effort to do that.
That's
properly.
The thing.
First,
you have
the training.
To practice.
I mean, you got to get a good trainer.
You have to practice and train. Absolutely.
Right. And then practice. And, you know, you can't just – a lot of people just have a knife and they think they can flick the blade open quick and they're a knife fighter. And you're not a knife fighter. Yeah, they're a good utility tool to have with you, but
– So, Judge, you've got a good question here on our text line. It says, I'm looking for recommendations for a home defense weapon for my wife. I'm working nights and she stays home by herself. Shotgun or handgun?
How about a new husband? That might be a good one that doesn't have to work at night.
Somebody's got to bring home the bacon.
Right. Just kidding.
So I don't think she's ever had a gun in her hands. And that's Pete from Pensacola. So recommendations is there. Definitely, for me, a handgun over a shotgun.
Well, if she wants it in the house, I would go with a 9mm carbine of some type because you're not going to get any recoil with it. There are a bunch of them, but you know the Beretta Storm is one. You could it's probably the most economical. You want to go really cheap, the High Point carbine. The problem is it's only got a 10-round magazine to it. You could go with the Kel-Tec Sub 2000, but no recoil. It's always easier to shoot a carbine than a pistol.
Yep.
Because you've got more points of contact. Not going to be as loud. You get a little more speed out of the bullet. Not that that particularly matters. But if you're just going to keep it in the house. But first of all, I might buy a dog before I did anything and make sure all the windows are locked. Doors and windows are locked securely before you do anything.
But that's a good point. I mean, if you have those doors and windows locked securely, then the person or the bad guy
Most
or potential
bad
guy
else.
Will go to the next house
right.
if they're locked up. But the question was a shotgun or handgun.
Oh, okay.
So you recommended a carbine, which is what I recommend.
Short
is,
rifle.
Yeah, a short rifle, which I recommend as well. But the thing about it, if you're just going to buy one.
It's between a shotgun and a handgun. Go with a handgun.
Yeah, absolutely. And that way you can use a handgun later as she becomes more comfortable with it to use it to conceal carry as she goes to
shotgun
Walmart.
Shotgun is just too difficult unless you're going to really put in a lot of time. And for somebody that's never held a gun, I just wouldn't put them
in a shotgun. Especially a woman because shotgun is so much recoil.
Yeah. And so loud, I wouldn't do that.
All right, join us next time. This is Armed Alabama. Anybody.